from the CNBC-TV18 headquarters in Mumbai.
When we have imposed the surcharge on a people or the individual or the association of person or the trust earning more than 2 crore or 5 crore, so this is the surcharge which has been imposed. There is a very, very solid, you know, reasoning behind it. Income constitutes what? Income from the salary, income from the rent, income from the business, and income from the capital gain, income from the short-term capital gain. Now, from wherever this capital gain, for example, in this case of FPI, now, this is a case where certain capital gains are being made, either the long term and the short term, and then whatever is the income tax is computed. On that, this surcharge has been increased.
Good morning. Welcome to Bazaar Morning Call. I'm Lata, with me Anuj and Sonia. Well, we just played out that bite because there is still so much confusion in the market whether the tax on FPIs will go away, since the intent was to tax actually those who are earning 2 and 5 crore and above. But I think the Revenue Secretary has made it crystal clear that that was part of the game plan, unless Parliament changes. So, of course, there is that caveat. Well, with that, let's come to what the world is looking like. The world is looking kind to India, although the SGX Nifty is indicating just a minor red tick. Crude oil prices have declined 3% overnight, and that's a big positive. Along with it, metal prices have actually increased, and that again is usually nifty positive because there are a substantial number of companies, Hindalco, Vedanta, and even the steel companies, which take a positive shine when metal prices are higher. So there is a global positive. The domestic positive can emanate if the bond rally sustains, and it could sustain because of the crude prices. But question marks will be on how much the bulls can retain initiative. To be sure, they can start green, but can they continue? That may depend perhaps on what Yes Bank results and Wipro results. Wipro results are after market hours. I just want to make a point on this bank results. The two that came yesterday, Federal and DCB, are showing some incipient signs of pain. Federal, of course, was a very good set of numbers, but both of them have shown that slippages have increased. Both of them have shown that deposits are hard to come by. Because this rally is sustaining on an excellent performance from banks, I just wanted to put that on the table. Morning, both of you.
Hi, Lata. Good morning. Hi, Anuj. Morning. I think this caution is taken on board, right? I mean, if you look at the data as well, FIs have been selling for 11 consecutive sessions now. And yesterday, too, FIs sold, you know, over 440 crores or so. And that's also perhaps the reason why India continues to underperform in 2019, despite the little bit of run-up that it has seen. So far this year, the returns that MSCI India index have given is 7.5%, while Asia ex Japan and emerging markets are way ahead, almost a 12% return. So the caution still prevails. Having said that, support has been found at 11,500 on the Nifty. And the next important level that perhaps the street is watching is that 50-day moving average of 11,707. Anuj, morning. Do you think that level could be a hurdle for the market? I mean, considering that, you know, we've been trading within this band, every time we get to the upper end of the band, there is selling pressure. You think that could be the order of the day?
Morning, Sonia. First of all, I think in this market, you don't extrapolate. Simple as that. Every day is a new day. Yesterday, we had negative cues and still the market rose. Today, perhaps the market falls. Also what was interesting was that yesterday we saw support for the market from the non-bank and non-IT stocks. Stocks like Reliance, L&T, HUL, these three stocks, in fact, combined for about 25 points. So that's one important thing. So the base case now is that the bottom is at 11,500 on the Nifty. There's a risk of a 20 DMA halt on the Nifty. What is a 20 DMA halt? Essentially, if the market is in a downtrend and it has a rally, in that case, at the 20-day moving average, it halts. Similarly, if a market which is in an uptrend and falls, and if it stops at 20 DMA, it's a very powerful tool if there's a halt. If there's a halt, then the fall is big. If there's no halt, then the market can just, you know,
pierce through
it and just have a big rally. So where's that zone? That zone is between 11,700 to 11,750. Give or take 20 or 30 points. So as of now, if you've got long in the market at 11,500 thereabout, this zone would be a good zone to perhaps take some money home and then see if the market is stalling here or if the market is willing to move on from here. If the market is willing to move on from here, in that case, perhaps you'll get a re-entry opportunity and you can play on the upside. The reason I still believe there's a bit of a doubt here is because the bank Nifty, the way it's still precariously placed, 30,500, it's not building onto that. So it's not piercing that on the downside, but still 30,500 is a sacrosanct number. And one last point, even though, you know, one swallow doesn't make a summer, the market's willing to look at the valuation comfort now. And bad news is not being punished as much if there's a valuation comfort. The classical case in point yesterday was Ashok Leyland, which actually rallied 5% from the lows and ended in the green, which is what we discussed in the morning as well, that, you know, it's not a fresh bad news.
Just to some extent.
Exactly. So that way, Larsen and Toubro yesterday ended at the high point after that news came on that CRZ, so the coastal road. So that way, I think the market's willing to look beyond the immediate negative if there's a valuation comfort. So that, I think, is good. But as I said, is it a one-off or is it going to be the trend? That's something we'll find out.
You know, I just to take the point on Nifty Bank a little forward, the weakness, I mean, there should be a lot of strength from the tremendous rise in bond prices. I mean, bond prices have gone through the roof. But the point is, the banks which matter to the bank Nifty, like HDFC Bank, are not people who keep excess SLR. Mm. Excess SLR are usually with the public sector banks, and they don't matter to the index so much. Yeah. But all banks now, there is a bit of a caution on two areas. Growth, because deposits are not coming by that cheap. And the slippages. Two mid-cap banks are giving you this niggling worry that the slippage worry, which we thought is over and only have to be provided for, is just resurfaced.
Oh, absolutely. And apart from banks, the IT space will be in focus today. Not just Wipro, but a whole host of mid-cap IT companies coming out with their numbers. Mindtree, Tata Alexi, etc. So that's going to be one space to look at as well. With that, let's kickstart the show and tell you what our wise experts have to say as we head into trade this morning. Dan Feinman of Credit Suisse says there are several indicators pointing to a low single-digit returns for the second half of 2019. Valuations are roughly fair. Leading indicators point to a low single-digit upside. EPS trends are consistent with single-digit returns in the second half. They forecast a 2% upside for Asia ex Japan for the rest of the year. He sees the greatest upside risk from US rates, but says their house view is more bearish than consensus.
Okay, yeah, Credit Suisse has been a little more bearish. And incidentally, Dan Feinman is the person who has taken over from Sakti Siva, an important voice, the nominee in it, right? Let's get to more equity opinion. Michael Hartnett of Bank of America Merrill Lynch says the dovish Fed and trade truce have caused investors to reduce cash and add risk. But their expectation of an earnings recession and debt deflation still dominates sentiment. The pain trade for the summer remains up in stocks and yields. This month's survey finds that investors have added risk, rotating into cyclical plays and out of defensive ones. Average cash balance falls to 5.2% from 5.6%, still above the 10-year average of 4.6%. Investors' allocation to cash ticks down 2% to net 41%, overweight, also well above the long-term average. Oh. Allocation to global equities retraces almost all of last month's dip, rising 31% to net 10% overweight.
Okay, well, that's some equity strategies coming in. But it's interesting to see which way the money markets could head, because yesterday the rupee had a fall, as you can see, as exports, remember, declined for the first time in June in the last 9 months. So that has impacted the rupee yesterday. 68.71 is where we're at. Pramit Brahmabhat of Veracity says, despite positive US economic data, he expects the rupee will remain sideways for the day. Trading range for the spot dollar INR pair is seen at 68.30 to 68.80.
Okay, and on bonds, Dhaval Dalal of Edelweiss says Indian government bond yields continue to decline at a faster pace as market participants began to factor in the possibility of the repo rate at 5% in 1 year amid surplus banking system liquidity and strengthening of the global dovish wave. Recent economic data has reaffirmed weakening of the economy and has strengthened expectations of multiple rate cuts by the Reserve Bank, with special focus on transmission of rate cuts and lowering lending rates. As a result, benchmark bond yields have declined by around 20 basis in a week to 6.33. Expects the benchmark bond yield to consolidate around 6.25 before charting its next course lower.
Okay, let's talk about the global cues then. Here's Nigel with the worldview.
Well, the U.S. markets came in for some profit booking. They broke that winning streak that we have been seeing over the last few days. That's why all the three indices, they ended in the red. Trump spooked the street yesterday. He says that they have a long way to go with regard to, you know, striking a deal with China. He said that if they want, they can go ahead and levy those duties on $300 billion worth of Chinese imports. So that wasn't great news. But what was good news was earnings season kicked off, and it kicked off on the positive note. We had all these three stocks, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, as well as Johnson & Johnson. All of them reported earnings beat, though Johnson & Johnson ended in the red. The other couple of stocks ended in the green. Johnson & Johnson is under pressure because of their ongoing litigation with regard to the cancer risk on their talcum powder. Economic data continues to look very, very strong. The retail sales number came in at 0.4%. That was better than what the street was working with. And remember, this is after a couple of months of beat, it continued to look good. What it did was it gave some strength to the dollar index. The dollar index did jump up from sub that 97 level to around 97.4. And remember, the pound as well is showing some weakness because both the potential British prime ministers, that's Jeremy Hunt as well as Boris Johnson, they are talking about a harder Brexit. So on the back of that, the dollar index was quite firm. Crude oil prices, though, they have seen some selling overnight because, you know, U.S. State of Secretary, he says that, in fact, Iran is ready to make a deal out there. That's where Brent crude prices, as well as NYMEX, did see a bit of a downtick overnight. European markets, well, they ended in the green yesterday, but it was really about earnings reactions. You had, Burberry, that was up close to around 10% odd, reported strong sales numbers. On the flip side, Fiat Chrysler continues to see selling because Goldman Sachs had initiated, coverage on the stock with a sell rating. Economic sentiment coming out of Germany, though, didn't look good. A bigger than expected contraction. This morning, though, most Asian markets trading in the red because of those statements coming in from Trump that maybe they have a long way to go in striking a deal with China. For starters, SGX Nifty is indicating a bit of a downtick. Back to you guys.
All right. Thanks a lot for that, Nigel. But the other big issue is this FPI surcharge confusion. It has definitely hit market sentiment. If you look at what's happened in the last 11 days, foreign institutional investors have sold 4,500 odd crores. But the Revenue Secretary, Ajay Bhushan Pandey, has made it very clear. They said that they are convinced that this is the right thing to do. In an exclusive conversation with Shireen Bhan, the Revenue Secretary says that there was solid reasoning behind the move and the Parliament's decision on this matter will be final. Take a look.
Let me talk to you about some of the steps that you've announced in the budget and whether there is any possibility of a rolling back of any sort on some of those steps, sir. And I'll ask you specifically on the surcharge that's been brought in, not on individuals, but the surcharge that is now applicable to foreign portfolio investors and to trusts. Now, this is a matter that's up for discussion and debate. I understand that the Revenue Department has a point of view on this. So do you believe that this is the best way forward? Or do you believe that this is a matter that should be reviewed?
See, so far as the government is concerned, the government has expressed its intention, or it's a government proposal that we have taken to the parliament. And when we take any proposal to the parliament, we are fully convinced that this is the right thing to do. And therefore, you know, when we have imposed the surcharge on a people or the individual or the association of person or the trust, earning more than 2 crore or 5 crore. So this is the surcharge which has been imposed. There is a very, very solid, you know, reasoning behind it, solid, case for this.
So it is not an unintended consequence. This was very clearly thought through by the tax department that this will be applicable to FPIs, to AOPs, etc., and to trusts. So this was not an unintended consequence of the surcharge on individuals.
No. If you see the total income, now the income constitutes what? Income from the salary, income from the rent, income from the business, and income from the capital gain, income from the short-term capital gain. Now from wherever this capital gain, for example, in this case of FPI, now this is a case where certain capital gains are being made, either the long-term and the short-term, and then whatever is the income tax is computed, on that this surcharge has been increased. Now, in that respect, for example, supposing tomorrow says that was a rental income was considered while increasing this. So what my answer would be that, look, when we have decided to impose surcharge on the income tax, then whatever constitute income tax, everything is already covered there. Right. So whatever is the component of that income tax,
okay,
because the surcharge is on the income tax, so yeah, therefore it is a very, very conscious decision.
All right, so it's a very conscious decision, this imposition of surcharge on FPIs. He's made it very clear.
On those who don't come via the corporate entity, which is only 20%. And I think there should be no confusion on this. Absolutely, from day one, there should have been no confusion on this, that this is going to be applicable if you are via a non-corporate entity. And, you know, especially the Category 3 AIF, and you have to, you know, get a corporate entity, or you have to pay the surcharges. And, you know, if you're hoping that something will change, hope is not a data point.
Okay, well, the Revenue Secretary made it very clear in that exclusive with CNBC-TV18. But let's do one thing. Let's get back to the markets and drill it down to specific stocks. Our list of top 10 stocks is lined up in just moments from now with our entire research team. Here they are. So we'll head into a short break and be back.